adolescent PCOS diagnosis and management. So without further ado, may I request Dr. Suvidha to deliver her talk on adolescent PCOS. Thank you. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Prachi. Good evening, everyone. I'm Dr. Suvidha, presently working in Vishakhapatnam AMC as a civil assistant surgeon. And my topic for today is adolescent PCO. Adolescent PCO, as we all know, is one of the very important cases which we see, you know, in our general OPD. It's very often that, you know, we see anxious mother coming down and asking that her little girl is having menstrual abnormalities. Abnormalities like what? Like she's not...
Ma'am, sorry to interrupt you. Ma'am, we want to see your slide. So if you can share the slide.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, 1 second.
Yes, yes. There's a share screen below, so if you can just click on it.
Yeah, I'm doing it. Oh, sorry for the dispense. 1 second.
Ma'am, keep your slide deck open and then you click on share screen.
Yeah, it's open. Yeah, it's already open.
Chitrakala, can you help?
Rachi, Chitrakala, if we have the deck, we can share the screen.
No, I don't have the slide deck, sorry.
Yeah.
Yeah, can you see the presentation now?
Yes, yes, we can see.
Yeah.
Can you keep it a presentation mode if you don't mind, ma'am?
Yeah, I do that. Yeah. So you can
yes,
do that. Yeah. So sorry for the disturbance, yeah. So let's quickly go into the presentation. So the topic for today is adolescent PCO. How do we diagnose and how do we manage? Very often we see an anxious mother coming, walking down into her OPD saying her little girl is having problems with the menstruation. And they say, this never happened when we were young. Why is it that, you know, we are having so many problems now? The answer is probably it is adolescent PCO. So what is adolescent PCO? Before we go further into the slides, the contents which we'll be discussing in this is, first, how do we define it? What is the prevalence? Is it increasing? And what is it now? What is the general presentation? And how do we diagnose it? And then, after diagnosis, how do we evaluate and then further treatment? Adolescence, as we all know, is the growing up age and traditionally defined as 10 to 19 years of age, right? And adolescent PCO is described as unexplained persistent hyperandrogenic condition. And the prevalence now is ranging between 1.8 to 15%. Why 15%? Probably we are over. Diagnosing it. And why either it is underdiagnosed or sometimes overdiagnosed. And the prevalence actually depends on the type of criteria which we are using to diagnose this situation and also the ethnicity. African Americans are more, it is more prevalent in the African American group. Then coming to the risk factors. What are the factors which actually predispose a child or an adolescent to PCO? First thing is she has attained a puberty really early, probably before 8 years of age. The baby is healthy as what mother says, or probably obese as what we term. A family history of menstrual irregularities, and if she is belonging to the African American group, all these predispose the child for PCO. Now, what is the course? Often she comes and asks me, okay, now you have diagnosed the baby as or the child as a PCO. So what would it be? Will it go, will it be progressive, or can we stop it? Do we have a cure? But the fact is, yes, it is progressive. Most of the cases of adolescent PCO do go into adult PCO. Then, what is the risk of progression? What clinical history tells us that for sure, or maybe the child will be going into adolescent PCO? One is the child is having a persistently regular cycles, almost 6 years, 6 to 7 years after attaining MENA, first thing. And then persistently anovulatory cycles. That means she is bleeding only on withdrawal 3 years after MENA. And there is an increased BMI. These three conditions or these three clinical situations do hint that the child might end up into a full-blown adolescent PCO picture when she grows up. Now, as traditionally, as we have known, PCO is a endocrinological disorder, and the basis was given as an increased LH leading to increased testosterone or ovarian androgens. Now, going further, there are other hypotheses or, you know, mechanisms which have been postulated. The first one being a metabolic pathway, wherein there is a problem with the signaling caused due to decreased myo-inositol, and this leads to hyperinsulinemia. That is the first pathway. And the next one is gut dysbiogenesis, which is coming up now. Here, the dogma for this is there is an increase. They state that there is an increased gut mucosal permeability, which causes the gram-negative bacteria to enter the circulation, causing low-grade chronic inflammation, which interferes with the insulin receptor function. This leads to insulin resistance, increased insulin or hyperinsulinemia, and leading to ovarian androgen production. This is a study which says that there is dysbiosis of gut microbiota, which is associated with the PCO of adolescence. Now, a simple flowchart showing evolution of PCO. There are multiple environmental factors and genetic factors. There is a genetic predisposition leading to inositol deficiency, as we have discussed, leading to deranged insulin signaling. And this causes hyperinsulinemia, stimulating LH production, and therefore there is increased ovarian androgenesis. And this goes as a vicious circle, and it continues. Now, as we have seen from the picture, generally a normal follicle contains myo-inositol, higher levels of myo-inositol, and a ratio of 100:1. But in the case of a PCO, the level comes down to as much as 0.4. Now, this is the same thing which we guys have discussed now. That is, there is a disruption in physiological levels of MI, which causes deranged insulin signaling, causes impaired glucose metabolism, then increased LH and hyperandrogenemia. Insulin resistance is increased, and this causes irregular menses. Because of the hyperandrogenemia, we have hirsutism, acne, and alopecia. Now, we are done with the pathogenesis. So, the central dogma of pathogenesis is there is hyperinsulinemia, which we have to pick up, leading to hyperandrogenism, which is one of the clinical traits, and biochemical feature, which is very important, and this leads to irregular menstruation, right? So as we have discussed, the presentation will be menstrual irregularities, a chronic anovulation, hyperandrogenemia, which is clinically diagnosed as presence of a persistence of acne, hirsutism. Hirsutism is presence of coarse hair, and androgenic alopecia. Then biochemically, we have hyperandrogenemia and a PCO picture on ultrasound, as you guys know. Now, what are the frequency of symptoms? Does a child with PCO have to have all these? Not necessarily. A few present with menstrual disturbances, and it is one of the commonest presentation. It is present in 70% of cases diagnosed as adolescent PCO, and the incidence is higher in obese PCO patients. That is around 80%. When it comes to lean PCO, it comes down to around 30%, and therefore there is a delay in diagnosis of lean PCO until they reach their reproductive age. And in menstrual disturbances, presentation can be really varied. The girl can present to you with abnormally heavy bleeding, which might as well lead to anemia, and this is present in around 10% of cases. Sometimes prolonged amenorrhea, she might come to you for a withdrawal. And then most common presentation is oligomenorrheic cycles. That means she's getting a cycles once in probably 40 days or 50 days. Then next presentation generally is around the late teens, when they come to you with the most important complaint of acne, and probably most of them go to a dermatologist, and then probably they are ended up diagnosed as PCO. And percentage of acne is around 70%, hirsutism, of coarse hair or facial hair, around 50 to 60%. Then acanthosis and marker for hyperinsulinemia in 10% of patients. And among these cases, around 50 to 60% people are obese. And above all this, you might also have cases with normal menstruation that accounts to around 20%. Now, the biggest problem is, are we underdiagnosing it or overdiagnosis? What happens if you overdiagnose? Is that okay? What happens if you overdiagnose? We are instilling a fear, a psychological distress to the parent as well as the child. So always be cautious before you diagnose an adolescent as PCO, and take care that you explain the mother and child that what is the problem with it. What happens if you're underdiagnosing? Underdiagnosing means you're missing unopposed estrogen action, and therefore you're putting the child for later risk of probably diabetes or endometrial carcinoma. Then the common diagnostic criteria which we use for any PCO is the NIH 1990 or the Rotterdam criteria or Androgen Access Society criteria. Adolescent PCO generally is diagnosis of exclusion. Before you tag a child as a case of PCO, please exclude all the hyperandrogenemic conditions. Then coming to diagnosis, we have been speaking that you have to be very strict with the diagnosis. So of late, we are using two criteria for the diagnosis. One is given by Sultan and Paris in 2006, and it requires around four out of five presentations, that is oligomenorrhea, amenorrhea, clinical hyperandrogenism, biochemical hyperandrogenism, hyperinsulinemia, and polycystic ovarian morphology in the ultrasound. Then the most, now androgen excess criteria, which we most commonly use, includes first chronic anovulation or oligomenorrhea, that is less than 6 cycles per year for around two years since menarche, or as well the child might present with primary amenorrhea at 17 years, any of it can be considered. Then clinical hyperandrogenism, as we have discussed, acne and hirsutism. But what a simple acne, every adolescent might have acne, but what type of acne should be considered? That which is unresponsive to topical treatment is what we have to consider for diagnosis. And a progressive hirsutism is also a very important sign. Then hyperandrogenemia. This is the most consistent marker which we can rely upon. That is, we go test for free testosterone or testosterone levels. And here the cutoff values are as those in adults, free testosterone being greater than 1.3 and testosterone greater than 1 micrograms per milliliter. Then, as we all know, most commonly used ultrasound criteria, and probably the use of ultrasound has made its diagnosis more cases of adolescent PCO. And here what you have is presence of 12 more follicles in the ovary within a diameter of 2 to 9 mm with increased ovarian volume. All these three should have to be considered. Then AMH, probably he gives under diagnostic criteria, but probably AMH in adolescent, you don't have to get it done for everyone. As we all know, AMH values are raised in cases of PCO, and greater than 4.5 is taken as a cutoff. These are the various clinical presentations in a pictorial view: acne, acanthosis, nigricans, hirsutism, and hair loss. And they will get on to infertility further. Now going to the evaluation part of it. How do we evaluate a case? A case walks in. What do I say first? the first issue would be I would want to examine her thoroughly, see if she is having greater terminal hair growth, acne, acanthosis, and skin tags. This is very important. Physical examination of the patient. Then obesity. How do you measure obesity? You calculate the BMI and also measure waist circumference. Waist circumference is to make hip circumference greater than 0.85 is an important marker. Then most of these girls who are really suffering from the menstrual cycles or really having acne have low self-esteem and do have depression and anxiety. So if you diagnose that the child is depressed, please do take help of psychiatrist in it. Then they do have obstructive sleep apnea syndrome. And the most worried thing which we are really worried about is onset of type 2 diabetes earlier in these. So in these cases, when the child walks in, I definitely get a HbA1c done. And even if it is normal now, please do remember that we have to rescreen the child once in 3 to 5 years, and more frequently if the child is having a central adiposity or substantial recent weight gain. Then cardiovascular risk should be assessed by taking the family history, history of smoking or hypertension and dyslipidemia and obesity in the family. Now, we are done with all these, moving on to the treatment. So the treatment is it is symptomatic and prophylactic. The most common question a mother asks you is, okay, now I'm taking these. So will it cure my PCO? Will it cure the PCO of my baby? So probably the most important part of treatment is to counsel the mother as that, as of now, what we are treating is the symptoms and prophylaxis that the child does not end up into something grave. And here, what is important is lifestyle modification so that the child restores back to her normal body weight. And then the next arm of the treatment would be cycle regulation. And then third, if this is present, hyperandrogenism, what we do is try to reduce signs of hyperandrogenism. Prevention of long-term health hazards. Long-term health hazards are first infertility. Then she might end up having a metabolic syndrome, early onset of diabetes and heart disease. So these are what we are aiming at when we are treating a child. So lifestyle changes, as we have discussed, if the child is obese, do prescribe her exercise, 150 minutes of exercise per week to reduce her weight, and 90 minutes of exercise per week to maintain her weight is important. And I do stress that it has to be done every day. It has to be done every day, and also should be made a part of a lifestyle and not just a short crash course. Then it should be followed either by OC pills or metformin. Metformin is generally given in cases with impaired glucose tolerance, which features of metabolic syndrome, acanthosis nigricans. OC pills, the type of OC pill we describe or we prescribe depends on the other problems she's having. Probably like she's having acne. In that cases, we give an OC pill in combination with anti-androgen like cipriterone acetate. So hormonal contraceptives, these are the first line for the management of menstrual disturbances and hirsutism. And this can be given either as pills or a patch. Vaginal ring is generally not preferred. Now I tell the mother, okay, I'm putting her on hormones. The first question comes, hormones for an adolescent girl? Madam, will it cause weight gain? Is it okay? Will she have problems with infertility? So those are the three questions definitely a mother would shoot at you. So before putting on her, please explain that weight gain will not be there because we are prescribing low dose OC pills. And for acne, this is the treatment of choice. And how many days should she use is another frequent question they asked. The duration of OC pills or usages of OC pills is not stipulated or prescribed or stipulated, but we can counsel her that it depends on how well you maintain your child's health, how well you make her exercise, what good food you give. And depending on that, probably you can cut down the OC pills once her cycles are regularized. Okay. saying all that, what are the side effects which OC pills can have? First thing is, there can be a mild deterioration of glucose tolerance. So if already she is diagnosed as a case of hyperinsulinemia, try adding metformin with OC pills. And there can be a worsening of lipid profile. Now, another important side effect is venous thromboembolism. So in what cases should we avoid putting OC pills? The risk of venous thromboembolism is high in cases where BMI is greater than 35. So in these cases, try not using OC pills and start using metformin, and probably you can use progesterone for withdrawal in these cases. Or you can use a third generation progesterone, which includes drospirenone. Screening for contraindications, lipid profile and glucose tolerance should be evaluated before and also after 3 months of starting OC pills. And greater than 40 BMI, please do not start a OC pill. Okay. Then next, coming to metformin. Metformin is used to treat metabolic syndrome, long-term resumption of ovulation, especially, And using metformin with OCPs has additive effect, and therefore, resumption of ovulation in those with inadequate reduction of weight is very nice. The result is very good with metformin. How do we start metformin? In lean PCO, 850 milligrams daily is fine. PCO, probably you can start with 500 BD and then go up till 1.5 to even 2 to 2.5 grams daily. Now, this is a study which states that metformin and COC have a comparable therapeutic effectiveness on cycle regularization in hirsutism, and metformin significantly improves insulin sensitivity. So combined metformin and OC pill, as we have said, have metformin here, attenuates the adverse metabolic effects of the OC pills alone. Therefore, a combination of metformin and OC pills is also recommended. Next, anti-androgenic medications. Where do we use and whom do we use? Those who are having really bad acne or very bad hirsutism. In those cases, we go for anti-androgens like spironolactone, flutamide, and insulin-sensitizing agents like pioglitazone. This is a table which shows the effect of lifestyle, combined OC pills, metformin, and anti-androgens. Menstrual dysfunction, best controlled by lifestyle modification and combined OC pills. Hirsutism by combined OC pills. Acne by combined OC pills and anti-androgens. Hyperandrogenemia by combined OC pills and anti-androgens. And insulin resistance, best by metformin. Now, since that we have discussed so much about myo-inositol in pathogenesis of PCO, myo-inositol is shown to have effective role in reducing hirsutism and also regularization of cycles, provided you're giving it in optimal dosages, that is around 4 grams per day. And these tablets have lower absorption, tablets or capsules have lower absorption and can alter efficacy. Now, this is a study which shows that clinical data which demonstrates the efficacy of myo-inositol in treatment of PCO, and these evidence are strongest for the dose of 4 grams per day. So, conclusion of this is administration of myo-inositol is safe and effective to correct metabolic disorders in teenagers. Combining myo-inositol with antiandrogens with the other treatments, there is an enhanced negative impact of those are nullified. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
Yeah.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. We will take the questions at the end of the session.
Oh, okay, sure.
We have another excellent speaker, Dr. Vani Esukapalli. So I'm very honored to introduce ma'am. Ma'am is professor of Obs and Gynecology Department of Government Medical College in Srikakulam. Ma'am has also done fellowship in advanced course in medical education. also ICMR fellowship in biomedical research. Ma'am has multiple publications in scientific journals and also recipient of best paper awards in various state conferences. Ma'am had delivered many guest lectures and conferences and seminars. And with this, may I request ma'am to talk on recurrent vaginal infections and what to do. So thank you, ma'am, and over to you.
Yeah. Good evening, all. So hope I'm audible.
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. So I'll be sharing my screen.
Yes, ma'am.
So hope the screen is also visible to all of you.
Yes, ma'am, it is visible.
Yeah, yeah. So thank you so much for involving me in this webinar. So my topic would be even more commoner topic, more common topic, and even more worrisome topic to majority of the women. So recurrent vaginal infection is the most worrying factor in their lifetime. We very often see women going from clinic to clinic with no relief for their vaginal discharge. And many of them are even more worried that this recurrent vaginal discharge could be pointing towards any malignancy. So that is also there. So what to do in such cases of women suffering from recurrent vaginal infections? So when I say recurrent vaginal infection, I mean that at least 3 attacks in a month, in 6 months period. So that is what we mean by recurrent vaginal infections. If we go into the basics, we know that there are so many natural defense mechanisms within the vagina. So it is a God's gift to women that there are so many natural mechanisms within the vagina to combat with the various pathogens. The microbial species that inhabit vaginal tract, they themselves play an important role in prevention of any other pathogen. At least 50 microbial species have been recovered from the vagina in various studies. The gut, at least 800 species were recovered. So not as much as 800, but at least 50 microbial species have been recovered from vagina. And these are all non-pathogenic. And healthy vaginal flora, majority is comprised of lactobacillus species. So this unique species is very friendly to the vaginal epithelium. And this acts as a barrier in the vagina, interfering with certain pathogens. Let us call them as uropathogens. So that means pathogens, we have a predilection towards vagina and the urinary tract. So the healthy vaginal flora acts as a barrier within the vagina, interfering with the uropathogens. And this healthy vaginal flora, I already said, it is the lactobacillus species. The most common species, there are at least 200 such species of lactobacillus. The lactobacillus inus, crispatus, gasseri, and bifidobacterium. So these are the most common species of lactobacillus, which are very, very friendly in the vagina, and which are interfering with the uropathogens. So there is a dynamic equilibrium that exists within the vagina. A healthy vagina has a good ecosystem. So this good ecosystem will be maintaining the dynamic equilibrium. So this equilibrium is between the vaginal epithelium cells and with the normal colonizing organism within the vagina, that is the commensal organism, lactobacillus, which are maintaining the local secretory and immune responses also. So ultimately, when the vaginal epithelium, which is a stratified squamous epithelium, along with the normal colonizing lactobacillus within it, with good local secretory and immune factors, a good pH is maintained. So what is the pH? It is an acidic pH, anywhere between 3.8 to 4.2. So having an acidic pH within the vagina is the most important natural defense mechanism that exists within the human vagina. So this acidic pH creates a very unfavorable environment for the pathogens. So this vaginal microbiome, so it is not a single bacteria. So it is a combination of various bacteria that which are present within the vagina. So let us call it as a vaginal microbiome. In a healthy woman, this vaginal microbiome responds to various physiological and environmental challenges. Before menarche, the vaginal microbiota are different. Only few lactobacillus are present. And at puberty, because of the natural environmental conditions and because of the hormonal influence, the number of lactobacillus will be increased. And from then onwards, the natural defense mechanism automatically starts in the human vagina. In healthy individuals, this lactobacillus species dominate the ecosystem within the vagina, and the concentration could be somewhere around 10 to power of 7 to 10 to power of 8 colony forming units per gram of the vaginal fluid. So such is the prevalence of the lactobacillus within the vaginal fluid. So as I've said, the vaginal microbiota are not constant throughout the human life. The vaginal epithelium itself is very, very sensitive to estrogens and progesterones. So when we say the vaginal epithelium is highly sensitive to the hormones, what happens before puberty? The girl before puberty, we know that there's no follicular development. There is no estrogens. Let us call this phase as estrogen silence. And when there is no estrogen, the vaginal epithelium is very thin. So normally it should be multi-layered, but here maximum 3-4 layers are present. And the cornification of the upper layers of the vagina is also not there because there is no estrogen. So when this cornification is not there, there is low glycogen production within the vaginal epithelial cells. When no glycogen, there are low lactobacillus concentration. So therefore, when the lactobacillus is not there, the vagina selects diverse microbiota, causing more of alkaline pH, so many pathogens invading the vagina. So that is the cause for the more chance of vaginal infections in a girl before puberty. The possibility exists. So then looking at during puberty and reproductive age, so once the follicular development has started, now you have abundant estrogen production. So this abundant estrogen production makes the thickness of the vaginal wall more. Upper layers are adequately cornified because of this estrogen. The cornified cells having more of glycogen. This glycogen being constantly shedding along with the vaginal cells into the vagina. And this glycogen is fermented by the lactobacillus, making it into lactic acid, glycogen broken down to lactic acid. So this lactic acid is the root cause of the acidic pH of the vaginal secretion. So this happens once the girl attains puberty and enters into the reproductive age. So this is the natural host defense mechanism that prevents the diverse microbiota to invade the vaginal epithelium and cause various infections. So having understood in the reproductive age, let us see what happens in the postmenopausal age, where there is a follicular depletion, the ovaries further stop secreting estrogen, producing estrogen. Again, the vaginal wall becomes thin. There are more parabasal cells rather than superficial cells. Low glycogen production, low or almost no lactobacillus. So therefore, alkaline pH, invasion by diverse vaginal microbiota, more chance of infections. So therefore, the normal ecosystem in the vagina is altered by the various phases in the woman's life before puberty, reproductive age, and after menopause. The same thing depicted in a different way. Estrogen is a cause for increased epithelial glycogen in the vaginal epithelium. When the glycogen quantity is more added on with lactobacillus, it breaks down glycogen into lactic acid. Lactic acid maintaining the acidic pH in the vaginal secretion. So when do we see abnormal pH? That means more than 4.2 is an abnormal pH in the vagina. Any trauma to the vagina, any conditions predisposing to hypoestrogenism during menstruation, or alkaline seminal fluid, whenever there's an alteration in the vaginal ecosystem, for example, in case of type 2 diabetes, so there may be some alteration in the vaginal ecosystem, the balance is tilted. Or any conditions where there is excessive epithelial desquamation of the vagina. So these are all the causes where you can expect an abnormal pH that is more than 4.2. The other important feature here is lactobacillus, the main bacillus responsible for conversion of glycogen to lactic acid, also produces hydrogen peroxide. This is another natural mechanism by which the vaginal infections are low in quantity when the lactobacillus is adequately present in the vaginal ecosystem. So therefore, now I think all of us have understood that lactobacillus maintains the vaginal homeostasis by producing lactic acid, by maintaining a good acidic vaginal pH, by producing hydrogen peroxide. It also produces another elements what are called as bacteriocins. So these bacteriocins are produced as a byproduct of lactobacillus. These elements, they prevent the bacterial growth of other non-lactobacillus organisms. They further do not allow attachment of the pathogenic bacteria to the walls of the vagina by a competitive inhibition. So that is how bacteriocins produced by lactobacillus also help in maintaining the vaginal homeostasis and reducing the incidence of vaginal infections. So what is this term vaginosis? Generally, we talk about vaginitis. Vaginosis is nothing but it's an abnormal change or tilting in the vaginal ecosystem. So here there's a balance between the lactobacillus and the pathogens. So this balance or equilibrium is maintained by the lactobacillus, and any tilt of this is what is called as vaginosis. So the tilt in favor of pathogens by the loss of lactobacillus will help excessive growth of the aerobic and anaerobic bacteria, which are normally also found in the vagina. So this is what is called vaginosis. The altered vaginal microbiota leads to recurrent infections. What are these recurrent infections? They could be in the form of bacterial vaginosis, vulvovaginal candidiasis, recurrent urinary tract infections, also trichomonas vaginalis, and certain pelvic inflammatory disease in causing pathogens. So here you kindly note the term bacterial vaginosis, because most of it's a polymicrobial infection, and most of these reside in the vaginal ecosystem, but under the dominance of the lactobacillus, these remain as commensals, and with the equilibrium tilted to in favor of the pathogens, these normal commensal, they become pathogenic. So that is why it is termed vaginosis rather than vaginitis. The most important is bacterial vaginosis. So let us understand what happens in case of bacterial vaginosis infection. Here, Gardnerella vaginalis is the chief organism causing bacterial vaginosis. The Gardnerella vaginalis bacteria adheres to the vaginal epithelial cells. So that is the first step. It adheres to the vaginal epithelial cell, and these may be shut down into the vaginal secretion. So these are themselves called clue cells. And this vaginosis also causes gaps within the vaginal epithelium, and these gaps within the vaginal epithelium and the chopping off of the sialic acid from the host immunity will further increase the adherence of the Gardnerella to the vaginal cells. So then the next step, so first is the adherence, second is the replication. So now the number of the Gardnerella vaginalis bacteria replicate to form into more numbers. And when they are in more numbers, they attach to the whole of the vagina in the form of what is called as a biofilm. So they have coated the vagina into a biofilm by consuming more amount of vaginal mucosal proteins. So at this stage, the very common symptom, which is very characteristic of bacterial vaginosis, that is a fishy vaginal odor, starts. The vaginal mucosa becomes very, very thinner because the whole of it is being consumed by the Gardnerella vaginalis, and it dissolves, the vaginal epithelium dissolves and then forms a homogeneous thin discharge, which is another important feature of the AMSL's criteria to diagnose a case of bacterial vaginosis. The clue cell, so what are marked in asterisks, clue cell, fishy amine odor, homogeneous thin discharge are the important features of AMSL's criteria along with the pH. So then there is an enhanced endurance against the lactobacillus. The quantity of lactobacillus slowly comes down, and this also becomes a feature in AMSL's criteria. So that is how the pathophysiology happens in a bacterial vaginosis infection. So let us see what happens in vulvovaginal candidiasis. Here also the first step is adherence of the candida, followed by invasion into the vaginal epithelial cell. So when it has invaded into the vaginal epithelial cell, it triggers a directional hyphae formation. So when the hyphae formation has been triggered, once the candida has adhered to the vaginal wall, here also again a biofilm of the infected pathogen occurs on the whole of the vagina. So this biofilm in turn triggers the proliferation of the yeast cell, and the maturation of the yeast cell again into hyphae formation, all this happening as a vicious cycle. Finally, the fungal load becomes far more, and then the chief symptomatology of the vulvovaginal candidiasis, that is pruritus, vulval soreness, the cottage cheese like vaginal discharge, all of them ultimately happen when the fungal load has exceeded the lactobacillus. Then in case of trichomoniasis, which is another common vaginal infection, again the first step is adherence of the virulent Trichomonas vaginalis to the vaginal epithelial cell. So this activates the adhesins in the vaginal, in between the vaginal cell. So when this, after this, there's the proteolytic degradation of the mucosal layer of the vagina. Again, there's a vaginal discharge, which is not typically fishy odor, but definitely has some foul smell odor. A homogeneous, copious amount of discharge happening. Then there is elongation of the Trichomonas vaginalis, which I mean the pseudopods, it's a protozoal organism. So a lot number of pseudopods from this protozoal organism start to begin. They interdigitate at the site of the contact and invade into the host immunity. So finally, lot amount of growth and proliferation of Trichomonas vaginalis happen. So then the actual symptomatology, that is a copious vaginal discharge, foul smelling discharge, greenish yellow in color, in frothy type of discharge. So these finally happen. So when the proliferation and growth has overseeded the lactobacillus. So in all these three, we have understood whatever is the pathogen, they overseeded in their growth and proliferation the natural commensal, that is a lactobacillus. So if you look into the different differential diagnosis of various common vaginal infection, we can understand in bacterial vaginosis and in trichomoniasis. In bacterial vaginosis, for sure the vaginal pH is more than 5. In Trichomonas vaginitis, it is around 4.5. Not sure in case of candidal vulvovaginitis, it could be less than 4.5, but not less than 4.2. So this is enough for this slide, the differential diagnosis, where I want to concentrate on the pH and what happens to the pH in the different type of vaginal infections. So these are all very, very common. A combination also is possible. Bacterial vaginosis, any women would have experienced at any point of their time, 40-50% of women would have experienced a bacterial vaginosis. Vulvovaginal candidiasis, at least 20-25%, and more so in case of diabetic women. In trichomoniasis, 15-20% of women in their lifetime would have experienced some sort of Trichomonas vaginalis. So the management, the standard management is you have to handle the pathogen. So that is the basic logic. So therefore, metronidazole, clindamycin. So these are the two common drugs which are used. Metronidazole, tablet form, 500 milligram, 3 times daily for 7 days, or as a gel preparation, can be used. Clindamycin either as a cream, intravaginally at bedtime for 7 days. So this is in non-pregnant women. So during pregnancy, metronidazole can be also safely used. Clindamycin can be used as a oral format. So this is the management for the common vaginal infection, either bacterial vaginosis or Trichomonas vaginalis. And for candidiasis, you'll be using antifungals. Whatever is the drug, either antifungal or antibiotics. They do not restore the vaginal microbiota, which have been altered because of the altered ecosystem. They do not also restore the defense mechanism, which is normally present in the vagina. The other important thing is this antifungals or antibiotics, whatever we have talked about, they do not offer any resistance to the biofilm forming pathogens. So at that point of stage, probably the antibiotics and antifungals, they don't work as effectively. So probably this is a cause for the high recurrence rate. So we are only thinking of the pathogen by giving antifungals and antibiotics. We are forgetting the fact that the natural microbiota also has to be restored. So probably that is a cause for the high recurrence rate of vaginal infections in women. Though antifungals and antibiotics are the mainstay, so it is very logical to handle the pathogen, exact pathogen, but recurrence rate is high. So therefore, we have understood that to decrease the recurrence of any of the vaginal infection, we have to concentrate on the ecosystem of the vagina. So how to concentrate and prove that, improve the natural defense mechanism, what to do? Probably probiotics is an answer. Probably it is ideal treatment when you think it logically that we have to restore the ecosystem within the vagina. So here, the maximum colony forming units of the lactobacillus, that is 10 billion colony forming units, is to be ideally supplemented from exogenous source to maintain and to re-establish the lost vaginal ecosystem. Probiotics contain lactobacillus, which are very, very helpful, and we have already seen how helpful they are, how they have become the natural defense mechanism in the vaginal secretions. If used for a significant period of time, though not as an alternative, or actually they should be an add-on to the antibiotics, particularly in cases where there's a high infection and you are thinking that the recurrence rate would be higher, surely probiotics will be an ideal answer. So this microbiota varies between races, varies between environmental, and varies with food habits of the individual. So the strains of lactobacillus, which are predominating in Indian women, are to be supplemented. So therefore, only indigenous strains, which have better efficacy on the local population, so those are the species of lactobacillus which have to be supplemented. So those strains which are designed for Western origin, so they might not be functioning optimally in our population. So the seven vaginal specific strains, Acidophilus, Rhamnosus, Ruteri, Plantarum, Casey, Fermentum, and Bifidobacterium bifidum. So these are the seven vaginal specific strains found in Indian women, totally counting to 10 billion colony forming units. So they appear to be better species to be supplemented along with antibiotics or antifungals. There are so many studies, so we don't believe the common words or something anyone would say. So we need some evidence to prove it. So there's so many studies which have proved that probiotics with adequate amount of lactobacillus, which is specific for a particular population, will definitely help in restoring the normal vaginal ecosystem. So a study very recently in June 2020 have revealed that women taking adequate amount of probiotics for their bacterial vaginosis, they had good improvement if vaginal probiotics were also added in conjunction with the metronidazole. So this was a very recent study which has proved the fact. I said Gardnerella vaginalis forms a biofilm, and it is very tough to eradicate this biofilm after it has formed by the routine antibiotics. So when the probiotics have added along with the antibiotics, so definitely the depth, the density, the surface area, all of them can be handled better, and you get an optimal treatment for the Gardnerella vaginosis. There's another study saying confirming the potential efficacy of orally administered probiotics restores and maintain the ecosystem in the genital system, and have shown that over 10 to power of 8 viable organisms can be established per day with a given required dose. So the advantage of oral administration of probiotic, they have successfully survived the low pH and bile salts of the stomach. They pass through the intestine and they then ascend without functional intervention of the vagina. So the oral route is good and advantageous, and this route is more easy for the woman to take, and it has been proven beyond doubt that oral route of administration is enough for the restoration of the lactobacillus species in the vaginal ecosystem. So the same thing shown in this also. It's an Indian trial which has proved that the severity of symptoms when probiotics have been used in the treatment of bacterial vaginosis, they have disappeared from day 4 and significant disappearance on day 7. So they have started to disappear from day 4 itself with a good significant disappearance on day 7. So this study was done for the 3 important symptoms of bacterial vaginosis, that is pruritus, the vaginal discharge, and the odor. So all the 3 had significant improvement right from day 4 and almost total disappearance by day 7. So this is another study which have said that the beneficial microorganism, that is the probiotics, they can aid recovery from infection to maintenance. So that is more important. So it is not just recovering from infection. The maintenance of the pH post-infection is very important, and that can be achieved through probiotics. So the same thing, another study. There's another study yet which has concluded that probiotics can be used for prevention also. Prevention and treatment for post-menopausal vaginal infection, because that is the age where there's more chance of vaginal infection. So I think now the audience would have been convinced that by addition of probiotics, there is a good reduction of symptomatology. It can be used for maintenance. It can be used as a preventive aspect also. So thank you very much for giving me the chance to participate in the webinar and for giving me a wonderful topic, which is very, very common. And I see many of my patients with this type of recurrent vaginal infection. So going from clinic to clinic, not satisfied anywhere. And my personal experience also to say that by giving probiotics along with antibiotics is a good move to reduce the recurrence rate of the vaginal infection. And so thank you so much, the organizers of the SHIELD health fund. Thank you.
Thank you, Martha, very much for this informative and very nice presentations. And it's really our honor to have you. Our last speaker and the last topic is poor ovarian reserve. And Dr. Y. Srujan would be delivering talk on poor ovarian reserve. Sir is a civil surgeon in King George Hospital, Visakhapatnam. So thank you, sir, and over to you.
Yes. Thank you. Can I have Ms. Chitra? Yeah. Thank you so much. And good evening, everybody. I'm Dr. Srujan. I'm a civil assistant surgeon at King George Hospital, Visakhapatnam. I hope I'm audible.
Yeah.
I'm audible, right? Yeah, thank you. Thanks a lot. Okay, yes. So today we'll be talking about poor ovarian reserve. Okay, and a few other things like follicle development as well. So I'll be dividing my talk into three parts. The first will be ovarian aging, the second will be the ovarian reserve, and the third will be ovarian reserve tests. So first, ovarian aging, I'll just go through briefly about it. So we all know that in a newborn, a baby girl is born about 1 to 2 months, which by puberty go down to around 400,000, and of which around 400 ovulate, and everything gets exhausted by the time she reaches menopause. So every primordial follicle is important, especially in a woman with poor ovarian reserve, they're all the more important. So first we go with, let me start with ovarian stimulation, the definition. Ovarian stimulation is defined as the pharmacological treatment with the intention of inducing the development of ovarian follicles. It is used for two purposes. One is the thing which everyone uses these days, that is you induce ovulation and then ask the person to go for timed intercourse or go for IUI. And the second is for the infertility professionals in ART to obtain multiple oocytes for follicular aspiration. Can I have the next slide, please? Yeah. So response after ovarian stimulation was initially classified as poor, normal, or okay. Since these terms stigmatize for the woman while counseling, ESHRAE now recommends this ovarian response to be classified as low, normal, or high response. So poor responders, normal responders, or excessive responders to ovulation stimulation are now called as low responders, normal responders, or high responders. Low being women having 3 or less than 3 ovarian oocytes that can be retrieved at the time of giving the trigger is considered as low. Or women with greater than 19 oocytes, each greater than or equal to 11 mm at the time of oocyte retrieval are considered as high responders. Next slide, please. Okay, so now we come to ovarian reserve. What is ovarian reserve? It is a function of the number and quality of remains. So it signifies the number as well as the quantity as well as the quality of the remaining oocytes. And it can also be said as the reproductive potential of the woman. Next slide, please. Yeah. So what are the predictors of ovarian reserve? First, it's age, which is quite obvious. As the woman grows older, the ovarian follicles get atrophic and fewer the follicles. And the history of poor or cancer cycle. If she has had a very poor response to previous ovulation induction, and if she has had previous cancer cycles, that is an indication of poor ovarian reserve. And then ovarian reserve tests, of which among these, if she has at least 2, she can be said as a person having poor ovarian reserve. And among the ovarian reserve tests, the most important ones are antral follicle count and anti-Müllerian hormone levels. Next slide, please. Yeah, so decreased or diminished ovarian reserve. So these women, how do they present to you? They usually have a common regular menstrual cycles, but they have reduced quantity of ovarian follicles that are being recruited in each cycle. And they have limited response to ovarian stimulation and reduced fecundity. That is, the probability of achieving a live birth in a single reproductive cycle is low for them. Which is as opposite, as opposed to a woman reaching menopause or having premature ovarian failure. These women will have regular menstrual cycles, but they have reduced quantity of ovarian cycles per cycle I mean, she also has limited response to ovarian stimulation. Next slide, please. Yeah, what are the causes of diminished ovarian reserve? In most cases, the cause is unknown. It is unclear whether the diminished ovarian reserve is as a pathologic condition or it is because of the rapid atresia of the normal pool of oocytes or normal atresia of an abnormally small pool of oocytes, or it could just simply be the extreme end of a normal bell curve in a population. They could be rapidly atretic. The oocytes could be getting rapid, could be getting atretic quite rapidly, or they could be getting atretic at a normal pace, but she might be having a small initial pool of oocytes, or she could just be at the end of a normal bell curve, which has reached the extreme quite early in her case. Next slide, please. Okay, what are the factors for diminished ovarian reserve? First thing, advanced reproductive age. Any woman greater than 35 years is likely to have diminished ovarian reserve. Any family history of early menopause, any genetic conditions like 45X or Fragile X syndrome, conditions that can cause ovarian injury like endometriosis and pelvic infection, or any previous ovarian surgery for endometriomas, or if the patient had an oophorectomy, or the history of gonadotoxic therapy and pelvic irradiation, and if the patient is a smoker. Any of these risk factors can lead to diminished ovarian reserve. Now we come to ovarian reserve testing. Okay, what is the purpose of ovarian reserve testing? Okay, first, to predict the ovarian reserve and to assess the reproductive potential of the woman and identify infertility patients that are at risk for the diminished ovarian reserve and are more likely to exhibit a poor response to gonadotropin stimulation. This would help us in counseling the patient if we counseling and planning further treatment and the protocol that would be useful in such patients, and in assessing women who have a lesser chance of achieving pregnancy with ART. So discussing the prognosis and assessing the dose of the drugs that should be given in these women, and safety consideration should also, the ovarian reserve testing helps in assessing all these conditions. Next slide, please. Okay, so what are the indications for ovarian reserve test? Do we do it for all the women who present to the clinic with infertility problems, or do we do it for certain people? Okay, any woman greater than or equal to 35 years, who has not conceived even after 6 months of regular intercourse, or any woman less than 35 years with complaints like endometriosis, unexplained infertility, having a single ovary, has had previous ovarian surgery, or has poor response to FSH, or previous exposure to chemotherapy or radiation. Any woman who's greater than 35 years and has not conceived for 6 months, should go for an ORT, or any woman less than 35 years with any of the conditions which I've just mentioned should go for the ovarian reserve test. Okay, what are the types of ovarian reserve tests? So we have the biochemical tests, we have the dynamic or provocative test, and we also have the ultrasonographic test. Among the biochemical tests, they reflect the biology of the aging ovary. So they're more closely related to decreased fecundity. So the various types of tests are FSH measurement, which is on the third day FSH measurement, the anti-Müllerian hormone level measurement, the estradiol measurement, or inhibin B measurement. These are the various tests, biochemical tests, that are available. And we also have dynamic tests. Dynamic tests are provocative tests. These are usually challenge tests. We give a ovulation induction drug and see how many follicles we get. Okay, this is to assess the response of the hypothalamo-pituitary ovarian axis to a particular stimulus. Under this, we have the clomiphene citrate challenge test. Okay, and then next slide, please. Yeah, we have the ultrasonographic test, which is the antral follicle count and the ovarian volume measurement. And these days, we also have genetic biomarkers like single nucleotide polymorphisms for the FSH, LH, estradiol, and anti-Müllerian hormone receptor genes. But these haven't had such regular use in day-to-day practice. Yeah, next slide, please. Okay, what is an ideal ovarian reserve screening test? The purpose of screening test is to identify the person at risk for the disease. It should be reproducible, with low intercycle and intracycle variability, and high specificity. to minimize the risk of a false positive determination of decreased ovarian reserve in a woman with normal ovarian reserve. So basically, the ideal screening test is the one which should have maintained its fidelity within the cycle and between two cycles, and should have high specificity. We do not want a woman with normal ovarian reserve to be labeled as decreased ovarian reserve. So yeah, we're keeping this in mind. Can I have the next slide? Next slide, please. Keeping this in the next one. Next slide. Next. Yeah. So keeping this in mind, the tests which have been recommended by ESHRAE and which are followed are anti-Mullerian hormone test and antral follicle count and third day FSH measurement. Individually, these predict low and high responders, and combinations of these tests do not have any added benefit. Combining any two tests does not give us any excess information. Any single test is enough. The choice of which test to use should be based on your laboratory resources and the availability of a skilled ultrasonographer in case of ultrasonographic tests like antral follicle count. The tests which are not used and which are not recommended are ovarian volume, ovarian blood flow, inhibin B levels, estradiol level, estradiol as an individual test, and clomiphene citrate challenge test. Okay, next slide, please. Yeah, so the most appropriate ovarian reserve test to be used in practice as recommended by ESHRAE in its guideline in 2019 October are anti-Mullerian hormone levels and antral follicle count. Next. So how do you go about using an ovarian reserve test? First, while you are working up a woman, first use a woman's age. It is an initial predictor for the overall chance of success through natural conception or with ART. And then use one of the following. Use either antral follicle count or AMH or FSH, third day FSH, based on the level. So this is a table which is there. Antral follicle count less than 4 or less, that is the number of antral follicles on the third day of the cycle. 4 or less is low response, 16 or more is high response. AMH levels 0.8 or less is low, or 3.5 or more is more, and so on. Next slide, please. Yeah, what is the significance of these tests? All these tests, I detect the quantity rather than the quality of the follicular pool. Okay, all these are just quantitative tests, but for quality, the best surrogate marker is age. So the higher the age, the lesser the quality, but the quantity, for quantity, you have these reserves. Okay, so age is the best surrogate marker for the quality of an egg. And the significance is they give us prognostic information for counseling and planning the treatment options and in helping couples choosing the best treatment option. Next slide. And they help in predicting. Picking the response to ovarian reserve and determining the dose of the HMG and FSH protocol for stimulation that can be used. Next slide, please. Okay, and regarding the pool predictor value for non-pregnancy, okay, they should be used to exclude women from treatment only if levels are abnormally low. They should not be the sole criteria used to deny patients access to ART or other treatments. So this is something that should be borne in mind. Okay, any woman with an absolutely and abnormal level of AMH or antral follicle count, they should be can be considered significant. And a mere abnormal level and just should not be used as a sole criteria to deny patients access to ART and other treatments. Next slide, please. Okay, female age and the ovarian reserve test. They're useful for discussing the prognosis and recommending the treatment plan. They can be younger women with diminished ovarian reserve. I mean, they have reduced oocyte numbers, but they might have good ovarian oocyte quality. And they can be older women with normal ovarian reserve. They might have a good number of oocytes, but an age-appropriate decrease in oocyte quality should be expected. Next. Next slide, please. Okay. When the results suggest diminished ovarian reserve, how do you go about it? Okay, you go about with the standard infertility evaluation, you counsel the woman, and you tell her that the opportunity to conceive may be shorter than anticipated, and attempting to conceive sooner than later is encouraged, and a more aggressive treatment protocol should be pursued to achieve pregnancy. Next slide, please. Yeah, these are the few levels depending upon the age, like the standard levels of AMH, FSH, and AFC. I'll play this slide later. Can I have the next slide, please? Yeah, what is antral follicle count? Antral follicle count is the total number of follicles measuring between 2 to 10 millimeters that are observed during the early follicular phase on transvaginal ultrasound. Okay, follicles greater than 2 millimeters are sensitive to FSH and are termed as recruitable. So anything greater than 2 millimeters of follicle in the early follicular phase are recruitable by FSH. So 2 millimeters is the basic cutoff. Anything greater than 2 mm is counted for the antral follicle count. And this size, it correlates with the remaining follicular pool and the number of oocytes retrieved following stimulation. So they can be considered, this count can be considered as a surrogate, as a representation of the remaining follicular pool and the number of oocytes that are likely retrieved following stimulation. Okay, inter-observer variation does not affect the predictive power of this test. And automated 3D measurement for antral follicle count is available. Next. Okay, and a two-dimensional transvaginal ultrasound in the early follicular phase with follicles of size between 2 to 10 millimeters, mean diameter are given, number of antral follicles at a given time that can be stimulated by, these are the number of follicles that can be stimulated, and these are the follicles that are available for you for your oocyte retrieval. Okay, so in that way also it helps. Next slide, please. Okay, so this is a picture of the antral follicles. So, yeah. You need a skilled ultrasonographer to go for this test. Yeah, next. Next slide, please. Okay. How do you go for the antral follicle count? It is a systematic procedure. It should be standardized. First, you go for the scout sweep. I'll just tell you briefly, and then I'll tell you the practical recommendations for better standardization. Okay, it should be done between the cycle day 2 to day 4, antral follicle count, and count the antral follicles between 2 to 10 millimeters. And a transvaginal probe of at least 7 megahertz minimum is necessary, and a two-dimensional image should be taken. First, you perform a scout sweep of the ovary in both dimensions, and then you identify the follicle, and then you you measure it in both dimensions, and you go from one end to other end. The same thing is repeated on the other ovary, and the antral follicle count is your antral follicle count. Next slide, please. Okay, now we come to anti-Müllerian hormone. Okay, it is a glycoprotein secreted by the granulosa cells of the pre-antral and small antral follicles. Okay, it falls linearly with increasing age. Age increases, AMH decreases. It is not cycle dependent. You do it on any day of the cycle, you get the same value. It can be measured on any day. And it has less cycle to cycle variation than FSH. But the thing is, it is expensive. So, and it is also not affected by GnRH antagonists that are used for downregulation in IVF cycles. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so anti-Müllerian hormone, it is a glycoprotein produced by the granulosa cells, and it reflects the number of pre-antral and small antral follicles, that those antral follicles with the size of 4 to 8 mm. Next. Okay, the level of AMH will peak at 25 years and will decrease from then on. Okay, it is an early marker of diminished ovarian reserve. Next slide, please. Okay, these are the various uses of AMH. It will make a lot more. We can go to the next slide, please. Yeah. Okay, so you know we'll talk a few things about follicular growth. Okay, and a little about biochemistry regarding follicular growth. So as we all know, the follicular growth proceeds in this order. We have the primordial follicles, then we have the primary oocytes, the secondary oocytes, the pre-antral, small antral, large antral follicles, the vesical follicle, and the vesical follicle maturation. Next. Okay, so the various phases and their dependency on gonadotrophins. So up till the primordial follicles, the primary and the secondary oocytes are gonadotrophin independent. The pre-antral and the antral follicles are gonadotrophin sensitive, whereas the vesicular follicle and for vesicular maturation, you need the gonadotrophin. Next. Okay. Yeah. Before the initial recruitment, the primordial follicle, it is strictly dormant and it does not have, it is not gonadotropin sensitive at all. Okay. This stage is entirely gonadotropin independent. The cyclic recruitment of it will take place when it is in the preantral phase and it becomes sensitive to gonadotropin. And then eventually the gonadotropin dependency stage starts. Am I audible? Hello? Hello? Yeah. The gonadotropin dependency is established with expression of both kind of receptors, which is the FSH receptors and LH receptors. When those receptors are formed on the antral follicle, then it becomes gonadotropin dependent. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, so yeah, now I'm going to talk to you about two different glycoproteins. One is the growth differentiating factor 9-GDF9 and the bone morphogenic protein BMP15. Both BMP15 proteins are members of the transforming growth factor TGF and is expressed by the primary oocytes through ovulatory follicles in humans. GDF9 and BMP15 both contribute to preantral follicular growth directly by promoting androgen synthesis by theca cells and by enhancing FSH receptor expression in the granulosa cells. Okay, GDF9 and BMP15 are secreted by something known as KIT ligand. Okay, KIT ligand is responsible for secretion of GDF9 and BMP15 by its function of donating paired electrons. Next slide, please. Okay, so what is KIT ligand? KIT ligand is produced by the granulosa cells. KIT ligand is a receptor on the oocyte and theca cells and is required for the initiation of follicular growth and growth of oocytes. Oocyte-derived proteins GDF9 and BMP15 are secreted by KIT ligand and are very important for granulosa cell proliferation. KIT ligand acts on oocytes to enlarge and initiate transition from primordial to primary follicle, and it is also involved in differentiation of theca cells from stroma cells. And what is the role of anti-Müllerian hormone? Okay, anti-Müllerian hormone has critical roles in two steps of follicular growth. One is the primordial follicle recruitment, and the other is the dominant follicle selection. AMH prevents the faster recruitment of primordial follicles, and the absence of AMH diminishes the primordial follicle pool. AMH reduces the force of FSH-dependent increase in the aromatase activity in the LH receptor expression. This inhibitory effect of AMH on FSH sensitivity of follicles plays a vital role in the selection of dominant follicles. Each follicle exerts its own threshold concentration that has to be allowed to exceed for follicle selection. So basically, anti-Müllerian hormone will reduce or actually control the number of follicles that are recruited in each cycle of ovulation. So in people with decreased AMH, the number of follicles that are recruited is higher, which leads to faster depletion of the primordial follicles. So the level of AMH has to be at a proper level. Otherwise, there would be rapid depletion of the primary oocytes. Next slide, please. Okay, so we have the importance of AMH and antral follicle count for poor ovarian reserve. So to diagnose poor ovarian reserve, two of the following three criteria for the diagnosis of poor ovarian should be there. One is maternal age equivalent to or greater than the age of 40 years, and previous existence of poor ovarian response. That is the number of oocytes recovered in a conventional ovarian stimulation cycle to be equal or less than 3. Or presence of at least one of the following causes is encountered as and having antral follicle count of 5 to 7 and AMH less than 0.5 to 1.1. So yeah, among these, if you have at least 2, it can be called as poor ovarian reserve. Next slide, please. Yeah, now we have principles of dominant follicle selection. So according to FSH threshold theory, FSH stimulation accelerates growth of a cohort of oocytes. The follicle with the highest number of FSH receptors is the one that gets selected. And this is the dominant follicle And the day when the descending FSH curve crosses the ascending curve of LH is the in the mid follicular phase of life is when the dominant follicle is selected. Next slide, please. So we have a few ovarian stimulation protocols. You can skip the slide, please. Yeah, this and the next one. Yeah, next one also can be seen. Okay, yeah. Now we come to something known as the mTOR pathway. Okay, mTOR signaling is stimulated in granulosa cells of select primordial follicles. mTOR pathway is the pathway that leads to the secretion of the KIT ligand, and KIT ligand helps in secretion of GDF9 and BMP15. GDF9 and BMP15 stimulate FSH receptors, leading to cell growth, proliferation, and follicle development. Okay, so mTOR leads to KIT ligand production. KIT ligand leads to the production or secretion of GDF9, BMP15, which in turn increases the FSH receptors in the primary oocytes, leading to the proliferation and development into the follicle. Okay, next slide, please. Next slide, please. Yeah. So the demonstrable effect of mTOR is that it will give you antral follicle count of more than 7 and the AMH level of 1.1 nanogram per ml. Okay, so this is the significance of this entire mTOR pathway, and in its relation to secreting the KIT ligand, which in turn leads to BMP15 and eventually the recruitment of primary oocytes. Okay, yeah, so next slide. Yeah, this is what I have summarized here. Okay, and eventually it will lead to the folliculogenesis, and which will help us in getting a better yield. Yeah, and that would be from my side. Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much for this talk. Excellent talk, sir. We will have a Q&A session now. A few questions are already there. Doctors have posted questions in the chat box. So quickly, I'll go through that. The first question is for the Dr. Suvidha Ma'am, that is for PCOS. The question is, many adolescent girls come with a history of regular menses for 3-4 months. And after that, 3-4 months after the menarche, and then they suddenly develop amenorrhea. So how the counseling to be done in these cases?
Yeah, first thing is just sit with the girl and talk first. Is she having any acute stress syndrome, probably an examination coming down or a health issue or something? Second thing, did it happen to her any time before? Was it the first time she's having it, or did it happen to her before? And then nothing, there is no significant history, then probably you can go for a withdrawal for this cycle. Advise her on good food, proper exercise, and see if the same thing is recurring again. And yes, if it is recurring. Yeah, and if it is recurring again, please do go for the test, a scan to document a PCO. Then you always have your good old OC pills, and crimson is definitely a good one.
Right, ma'am. Thank you. Ma'am, the next question is again for the PCOS, and that is by Dr. Asuntha. The question is the role of crimson 35 in PCOS.
Yeah, crimson, as we have discussed, you know, OC pill with an anti. It is good. Also helps in adolescents with hirsutism as one of the clinical features.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you. The next question is, ma'am, I guess you have already answered this. Regarding short-term stress causing condition and recent weight gain. So yes, that you have already answered. The next question is, can we diagnose adolescent PCOS based on complaints and clinical examination only? So that also you have answered, but for the rest of the audiences, ma'am, please once again.
Basically, as we have discussed, do not underdiagnose or overdiagnose. So before you tag a girl as an adolescent PCO, please do go run a battery of investigations and an ultrasound, and see at least it is meeting at least 4 of the 5 diagnostic criteria to tag her as an adolescent. So don't be quick and, you know, cause unnecessary anxiety to the mother and the child.
Right, ma'am. Thank you. Again, next question is on the PCOS. This is by Dr. Chila Kala. Sir, ma'am, the definition wise, is there any difference between adult PCOS and adolescent PCOS as far as definitions are concerned?
Age and probably presentation would be different rather than definition.
Okay, right, ma'am. The next question is for regarding prebiotic. The question is to Dr. Vani ma'am. What probiotic do you recommend and the dosage?
So here the dosage, I would like to mention the 10 billion colony forming units. So that is the dose that is recommended. So which I cannot answer, the dose I can say. And okay. Then for I've seen in the chat box for how long also.
Yes.
So probably the ideal period would be between 4 to 6 weeks. Anywhere between 4 to 6 weeks, minimum is 4 and ideally 6 weeks.
Right, ma'am, thank you. Ma'am, next question is, would you prefer treating both the partners in case of recurrent infections?
I didn't follow, what is the question?
Would you treat both the partner as well, would you treat in case of recurrent?
It only for the female partner, will give probiotics.
Okay. How long, 4 to 6 weeks, this has already been answered. The next question is, what is the earliest age at which adolescent PCOS is diagnosed?
Physiologically, you know, most common presentation would be menstrual irregularities, and physiologically, for a girl to have regular menses, for the cycle, you know, the gonadotropin cycle to set up, it takes at least 2 years. And only after 2 years, you start working up PCO. So probably if she is attaining her mean arc by around 13 years, probably 15. And if the case is presenting to you as primary amenorrhea at around 16 to 17 years of age, please do put adolescent PCO in your mind.
Right, ma'am. The next question is also for the PCOS. The question is obesity a risk factor for PCOS or is it the sequelae of PCOS?
Risk factor. Definitely it is a risk factor.
Okay. Right. Thank you. Let me see a few other questions. Ma'am, those were the questions which were there in the chat box. So there are no more additional questions I can see. There were a lot of comments as far as the presentations are concerned. Many comments for all three of you and excellent presentations, especially for Dr. Vani ma'am as well. So thank you very much for the presentations and also taking the Q&A sessions. The next question is, ma'am, can we share your presentations with the audiences?
Yeah, sure.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Thank you.
So on behalf of all the three presenters, I would like to thank you for involving
thank
us in
much.
This webinar. And we also had a good time of discussion and presenting all the topics. So thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. It's our honor and pleasure to have you on this webinar. Thank you very much.